We're going to talk about the fiber arts, weaving, tapestry, embroidery in the Middle Ages. Now, I am not a fiber artist, so I don't know all the technical things, but we're going to look at this art historically. For the most part, fiber arts, when the weaving is done in the home, and embroidery, this kind of thing was usually performed by women for much of the Middle Ages. Later in the Middle Ages, weaving, of course, became a big industry, and men became weavers. The cloth industry was the basis of a lot of the economy. And even in England, in the later Middle Ages, in the 14th, especially the 15th century, you start to see men becoming embroiderers. And according to your textbook, the quality dropped off at that time. But we're starting a little earlier here. We're starting with probably the most famous piece of fiber art from the Middle Ages, which is known as the Bayeux Tapestry. And it's not a tapestry. It's actually embroidery on linen. And it is a number of pieces that have been sewn together. I think there now have been, some of them have been cut apart, but they have a border, as you can see, at the top and the bottom, and seams going down the middle. And they tell the story of the Norman conquest of England. So that certainly gives us a terminus antiquem of 1066, because the Norman conquest occurred in 1066. So it's generally dated, as you can see, a few years later, maybe about 1070 to 1080. Now, the point of view in this is the Norman conquest from the Normans' point of view. They thought they had an excuse, a reason to invade and conquer England. And this is shown in the in the embroidery that's called a tapestry. Now, at this time, women were the ones who did the embroidery. So I don't think there could be much doubt that women embroidered the Bayeux Tapestry. But of course, the question is, who really created it? Who did the artistic part of making the design? And that gets interesting because you sometimes run into the idea that, well, only men would be capable of doing the design. You know, the women could do the manual labor of embroidering, but the men, you know, are the ones who did the design. Well, yet, I would assume that since women did most of the embroidery, they probably did most of the designing of embroideries, that this would be their area of expertise. So why wouldn't a woman create the design? Just because, oh, you know, they're thought to be incapable? That doesn't make any sense. Here we see a little detail with King Edward, and the whole question of who should be ruling England starts with who does Edward appoint as his successor. And of course, there's two candidates, and they're both claiming that it is their right to succeed to this throne. And here we see a banqueting feast with a bishop. You'll notice that the embroidery includes Latin inscriptions telling you who people are, telling you what they're doing. There's a little architectural structures here. And as you can see, one of them is ecclesia, a church. On the borders on the bottom, you have different animal forms, which probably are very popular in not only in manuscripts, but also in embroidery, the decorative. And then the scenes of what's happening, the narrative is going on in the center. Here they're building the ships. And I particularly like this detail. We can zoom in on the detail here because you can see the embroidery stitches. Now, as I said, I'm not a fiber artist, but I think that those of you, if there are any of you who are, or if you know someone, they could probably tell you exactly what these stitches are. Now here we see them in the ships, and when they arrive, of course, they had to bring the horses over in the ships, so the horses are being taken off. It's quite detailed. You can see the word cabale for horses, and over here, militus, which is soldier. So the soldiers have arrived. One of the questions, of course, was who created the design? And one of the reasons that people claim that only a man could have claimed this design was because it has so many details of warfare, and including the technology. And one of the things that's very interesting is the use of stirrups. That was a new technology that the rider could brace themselves in the stirrups. And that made warfare from on horseback a possibility. Try to imagine somebody with a spear or a lance and without stirrups. They might very easily be unhorsed. They might lose their balance. It might do a lot of it would be a lot of danger to the person actually throwing the spear. But if you can brace yourself using stirrups, you have an advantage. So that was some of the things that they would say. Well, the boat building and the weapons and things like the stirrups. Women are involved in warfare, so how would they know? Except that's not really true. Because women, and we're talking about the noble women here, women were the ones who saw to the defense of the castle when their lords, their husbands, were away fighting. In fact, that was one of the ways the feudal system worked. In the warrior class, the aristocrats, we would later call them, the lords would pledge fealty to another lord, and they had to come up for battle when they were called out. Well, then they have to leave their territory, their castle, and who's going to defend it? Well, of course, they probably leave some soldiers, but frequently it was the wife, it was the lady of the castle who would see to the defense and to all of the things like bringing in the supplies and making sure you've got that boiling oil. Boiling oil to pour down on anyone who's trying to climb up your walls. And we do have examples, besides Joan of Arc, of women who seem to know what they're doing with warfare. Also, women of this class would have seen their brothers learning to fight from the time they were small children. The castle would have had soldiers in it. It wasn't like they were completely separate and would never see this. They would see stirrups. They would see horses. They would see all these things. I mean, they weren't being blind. This was the culture in which they were raised, in which the aristocratic class was the warrior class. So even if they were not trained to take up a sword, they knew what went on. So it seems to me that it would be a little strange to assume that only a man can create an image of male doings. Women saw men. They saw them fighting. There's one other kind of interesting thing about this that I thought I'd tell you. This is a legend. There's probably no truth in it all, but it's kind of cute. The story, the legend about this is, about who created it, was that Matilda of Flanders, the wife of William the Conqueror, and her ladies embroidered the Bayeux Tapestry. Well, of course, we don't have any idea, and probably is not true. But right there is that idea of the woman working in the fiber, creating fibers. And there is the idea of the woman who embroiders. And of course, it starts out as noble women and later then becomes more of a profession. I wanted to show you this. It's just an example of weaving. It's a picture that I took at the Diocesan Museum in Cologne, and it shows a 15th century weaving, and it's very intricate, as you can see, where you have animals and plant forms in rows and tremendously skilled. Now, I'll also tell you what I thought was really fun about this. Right after I was in the Diocesan Museum in Cologne, I went over to the Walroth Recharch Museum in Cologne, which is the painting museum. And there was a 16th century painting by Hus van Cleve, in which in the wings or the side panels, the donors were praying. They were kneeling at their prie-dieu. And over their prie-dieu over their little kneeling bench, there was a tapestry that looked maybe not absolutely identical, but just very, very much like this, with the borders of the I shouldn't say tapestry, it's a weaving, it's not a tapestry, but with the animal forms. And of course, it was just showing you that at least one of them has survived. Probably the most famous tapestry of all is the Cluny unicorn tapestry. There's two very famous unicorn tapestries, or tapestry series. One's in the Metropolitan Museum of Art, The Hunt of the Unicorn. That's in New York. The other is in the Cluny Museum in Paris, France. And so we'll take a look at this. Once again, we don't know whether women created this or men created this. I'm just showing it to you as an example of the idea that women were involved in textiles. This particular scene, I should tell you, these all seem to relate to the idea of the five senses. And we're not quite sure what this means. The inscription, as you can see, right on the top of the little tent, curves around in French. It says, Mon seul désir. Pardon my pronunciation, I don't pronounce French. I read it, but I don't pronounce it. But it means my only desire, or my sole desire. Now, what does that mean? It doesn't specify what the maiden's sole desire is. It could be in the context of courtly love, and her only desire is her beloved. One of the interesting things here, as you can see, the smaller maidservant is offering a jewel box to the woman, and she seems to have some jewels wrapped up in a kind of veil of fabric. And some people think she's taking the jewels from the casket. Other people think she's putting the jewels in the casket. It looks to me a little more like she's returning these jewels to the casket, in which case perhaps the idea is, now I'm taking off my jewels because they are not my desire. You know, my desire is something else. At any rate, whatever it means, because we don't know exactly, all of these tapestries, you see what they call the many-flowered, mille fleurs design, which we see in manuscripts and in here tapestry. And you'll also see the lion and the unicorn in each one, and little animal figures in the background. This is sight. Here the unicorn has come, laid its hooves in the lap of the young lady, presumably a virgin, since unicorns were believed to be attracted to young virginal maidens. And the woman is holding up a mirror with the unicorn reflected in it. So the unicorn is admiring himself in the mirror, as you can see. So this is the sense of sight. Here we have the sense of smell. The lady here is making a garland of flowers. Taste. Can't see in here quite what she's got, but she's obviously got something that's supposed to taste good. And then we have hearing, and they are making music with this portable organ. I think they call it a psalmody. And here we see touch, and the woman is both holding on to a banner, and she's touching the unicorn's horn. And I love this little detail of the lion with his big grin, sort of a somewhat human-like face. Of course, probably whoever designed the tapestry probably never saw a lion. And medieval lions are rather fun that way, because they become quite fanciful, and I just find them actually wonderful.